Hey guys, welcome to yet another show here. It is Keoster's Wrestlefest. It is wrestling's prime times, and I'm bringing you another list of things here now from the history of pro wrestling. We're going to have the first section will be on old segments from years ago, some great segments on the way. Then we're going to get into some movies from the history of wrestling. I'm going to have a couple of movie trailers. Then I'm going to bring you to my Hasbros section. I'm going to look at some old vintage Hasbros. And also we're going to have a look at some customs, some recent ones that I've discovered. Excellent stuff. Then we're going to show you some old VHS tapes from back in the day. It is SummerSlam month, so we're going to focus on SummerSlams. And then I'm also going to bring you some music videos featuring pro wrestlers. So that's all coming tonight on Keoster's Wrestlefest. Wrestling prime times. Two segments in particular tonight. The first segment I'm going to look at is a episode of the famous segment that used to be as part of WWF Superstars, the Funeral Parlor, featuring The Undertaker and Paul Bearer, usually interviewing another wrestler. So this section came from late 1991, November 1991 to be precise, and it was Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair were guests on the Funeral Parlor. And this was, of course, leading up to the Survivor Series, 1991.
Very cautiously approaching
Mr. Hogan,
what could be his casket.
Isn't it beautiful? Oh, yes. Made of the finest materials on the outside as well as the inside. Oh, your logo. It's so beautiful. You don't need to open it. There's nothing inside.
You don't think the Undertaker could be in it?
Well, yes, I do.
Expect the unexpected from here on.
No.
You're gonna make sure.
Just where you're gonna be laying on Thanksgiving Day. Yes.
Opening your own coffin. Hey.
It's kind of creepy, Gus.
Loony.
No, it's all
right. Wait a minute.
I promise you.
From behind, here comes the alleged real world champion. Ric Flair getting a bird's eye view of Hulk Hogan. Hogan reaching for the standing casket as Flair now confronting Hulk Hogan.
This is interesting.
Come on over here. You know how long I've been waiting for this very moment, big man, huh?
Hey,
you
I'll
know
tell
how
you.
Long the real world champion has heard the name Hulk Hogan. You know how long I've had to listen to you talk about the 24-inch pythons, big man. Well, don't be ashamed of those butterflies you got rumbling in that stomach right now, because big man, I just burst that bubble you've been living in, and I'm here on your doorstep with the real world championship belt. Compare the two. In closing, what are you gonna do? Hulk Hogan, when Ric Flair runs wild on you.
Let me tell you.
So-called real world's title, Ric Flair, against the real WWE champion, Hulk Hogan. You will find out, Ric Flair, not only will the thousands of little Hulksters out there be at your beckoning call, but Hulk Hogan
from the
will
heart.
Be right there.
Look, it's the Undertaker from the air. Undertaker hammering Hulk Hogan from behind with the urn, coming out of the coffin. Look at that. They're all over him. Flair, Undertaker, all over Hulk Hogan, trying to choke the life out of him. Undertaker, there with Ric Flair.
That's it. Let's go.
Roddy Piper and Randy Savage leaving the broadcast booth. Look out. Flair now by Piper. Both have chairs. Undertaker standing over the body of Hulk. Look at that. Undertaker not even flinching.
What's he doing?
Reaching down. Boom. Undertaker standing over Hulk Hogan. Ric Flair, the Undertaker. And unquestionably will be perhaps the darkest day in the history of Hulkamania. It unquestionably will be Hulk Hogan's bravest challenge at the Survivor Series.
Okay, we move from there. The next segment we're going to have a look at is one of the most infamous and famous, of course, segments in the history of WWF. And it was late 1991. And it was a segment of The Barber Shop. Of course, Bruce the Barber Beefcake had a famous segment called The Barber Shop. And most of the big storylines played out in these little segments back in the day. They didn't just go out to the middle of the ring and talk. It was the storylines were built up in these very well designed and well kind of orchestrated segments. And this one was the Rockers, the famous Rockers breakup. I alluded to the Rockers breaking up around the time of Survivor Series 91. Well, this actually came after that, and this was part of the famous barbershop scene. And of course, Shawn Michaels and Marty Jannetty were part of this. Let's have a look at the barbershop window scene.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn my back to you right now. And if you want to go on your own, then walk off and leave. If you want to stick together and make this thing work, when I turn around, we're going to shake hands and we're going to go on a rock and roll like the Rockers can do.
They need each other. You know that.
Sounds fair to me.
He's not going to walk away.
They need each other.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Rockers!
Told you. Glad to see that.
Told you.
Tag team specialists.
See, one without the other isn't any good.
Oh, I knew he was going to do that. I just knew he was going to do that. He don't need Jannetty. I told you that off and on.
Are you kidding? What a despicable act that was.
You got to stay here.
No!
Oh, my God. and then he tried to dive through the window to escape. Did you see that?
Are you blind?
What an act of cowardism. Oh, he's hurt. A plate glass window.
Oh, look at that. He's busted wide open. We need a paramedic here.
Is there a problem with the horse?
They're done. They're finished, Monsoon.
Yeah, there's a problem with you, Sean.
Rockers are history. 1 week away. Is he going to be ready for the Royal Rumble?
He don't look at that. Bleeding profusely.
What's redder than her nails?
We want to have a look at a couple of wrestling movies featuring wrestlers. So we're going to have a look at Hulk Hogan's Suburban Commando, which of course was a 1991 movie. The Undertaker was one of the villains in it. Of course, they went on to have a match at Survivor Series, so it was kind of played on from the film. And around mid-91, Suburban Commando came out. Let's have a look at the trailer for that.
Charlie Wilcox is having a bad day. But help is on the way. And his name is Chef Ramsay.
I'm here to rent the apartment.
Suburban Commando.
Honey, it's for you.
It's Hulk Hogan, like you've never seen him before. Skateboarding, child raising, crime fighting.
It's the mailman.
Charlie Wilcox has just discovered the solution for all life's problems.
Leave a message or take a seat.
I said take a seat. Funny, that's real funny.
Sometimes I just get carried away.
I'm just your landlord. I bring you an extra bar of soap when you need it.
For being a target for intergalactic bounty hunters is a little out of my line.
I was frozen today.
Hulk Hogan.
What a nervous guy.
Christopher Lloyd. Suburban Commando.
You got any idea what we're gonna do to you?
You're gonna pound my face.
What, are you nuts? This is the 90s. We're gonna sue you.
Okay, good stuff. All right, coming up now, going to have a look at another classic movie from the world of wrestling. This one, of course, features Rowdy Roddy Piper. And it was a film from 1986. Featured Dirk Benedict, the A-Team fame. He, of course, played Face on the A-Team. Also featured Tanya Roberts. Also featured wrestlers such as the Barbarian and the kid that was part of the Islanders, the Samoan guy. Also featured some other great big names from the world of professional wrestling. And Rowdy Roddy Piper, of course, was in it. Let's have a look now at this trailer to Body Slam.
You're a big time music business personal manager. Maybe a little down on your luck. But you're working on a big deal. Maybe things will change for you.
Hi.
Ow!
What do you want from me?
$67,811.19 to be very specific.
You're making the big move.
Hey, Scotty, how you doing?
No, whatever it is, the answer is absolutely not.
I've been thinking about our relationship.
What relationship?
Message for you, Mr. Smilehack.
But things could be better. Maybe you ought to branch out a little.
I need someone who takes no crap. Tough.
Tough.
Maybe you're on your way back to the top.
Smiling at your service.
We've got something for you.
What's that?
I pay.
From the director of Smokey and the Bandit, Body Slam.
Hey, what? Do something!
Stay right there.
It's the outrageous comedy where wrestling meets rock and roll, and a loser becomes a legend.
You don't need music to
rock.
You need...
Big
one.
Smilak, what is that, a stomach disorder or a disease?
Wait.
How about this, Mr. Smilak?
I should have stayed in the music business.
You're a dead man, Smilak. And you heard it here, folks, on Reza. Four of the greatest wrestlers, two top managers. I don't know about you, but I can't...
Body Slam, starring the A-Team's Dirk Benedict, Tanya Roberts, Rowdy Roddy Piper, Tonga Tom, Captain Lou Albano, and a host of familiar faces, twisted arms, broken legs, stubbed toes, fractured thumbs, aching backs, and lots of laughs.
body slam.
It's the Hasbro section of the show. I'm going to have a few Hasbros, then I'm going to review a few customs. So the first of the Hasbros I'm going to bring you right now, so stay tuned. Okay, so first one we have here is Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream. As you can see with Dusty Rhodes, he was one of the greatest, one of the quintessential wrestlers of the 70s and 80s. He, of course, was multiple time world champion in Florida, our championship wrestling from Florida. He was, of course, involved with Jim Crockett Promotions and had many great bouts with Ric Flair, for example. Such a great character. The American Dream, baby. So he came into WWF in 1989 and had a feud with the Honky Tonk Man, then had feuds with the Big Boss Man and Akeem the African Dream and a few others, and the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase and the Macho King Randy Savage. Great matches and feuds with them guys over the years. But the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, was a very, very rare figure. This guy, the carded figure of him would like go for like, I think, around 700 or 800 euro or pounds, and the loose figures actually were very dear as well. I got this guy on, I'm on a lot of Hasbro groups on Facebook, and I actually came across this guy. I'm trying to think of who it was that who actually had him. I think it might have been Guy Robinson, or it could have been JJ, one of them guys anyway. I bought Dusty Rhodes from, which was a great, great buy. This arm's a bit loose, but still worth it, because I don't play with them these days, but I love to have them as my part of my collection, souvenirs kind of thing. So yeah, Dusty Rhodes, American Dream, what an addition to the Hasbro collection. Okay, so we have the Nasty Boys here, Brian Knobbs, Jerry Sags from Nastyville. These guys were some of the greatest and some of the roughest tumble fighters in the history of the WWF, and they brought out some cool figures of them around 1991 after they beat the Hart Foundation for the titles at WrestleMania 7, of course. The Nasties nasticized their way through the ranks in the WWF. And this is the figures that Hasbro brought out of them in 1991. Cool, cool figures. Knobs and Sags, great likeness. And they, of course, made a big name for themselves in the AWA in the late 80s. And then transition to WWF in the early 90s when they bought up all the big stars from all the different territories. And the Nasties, definitely a top tag team. And they, of course, came in season 2. I think it was season 2. So there you go, the Nasties. Cool figures. This time we have the Ugandan Giant Kamala, the Ugandan Headhunter, as they called him in WCW in the mid-90s. But the Kamala, of course, made a massive name for himself in the WCCW and in Memphis Wrestling, the UWF, and USWA then later on, of course, in the mid-80s, in the early 80s. Came over to the WWF in 87, of course, having feuds with Hulk Hogan, among others, and Jake the Snake. And of course he then went again, he came back into WWF in early 92, or mid 92, and he had feuds with The Undertaker, and he had other matches with Doink the Clown, among others, in a good run until mid 93. But Kamala, one of the baddest animals in the history of wrestling, he was, of course, big figure, great, great figure, and what a rare figure as well, as part of the WWF. He was, of course, he was in one of the later series, I think it was Series 5 in the Hasbro series. Kamala, one of my favourites. I just got him there probably about, got him years ago, but I got him about 6 months ago again. And he's a great one to have in the collection because he's so rare. Of course, the star and the stomach kind of design was not on the original. The prototype had the moon like he does in real life, but the star one, there was some disagreement there, and they decided to make it like this. But still good to have Kamala as part of the collection. So there you go, folks. Some more Hasbros, part of my Hasbro collection there. And on this episode of the show here on YouTube, you are watching CKTV here on YouTube. It is Keoster's Wrestlefest. wrestling's prime times. And the next section is about the customs collection. So, as I mentioned on the last show, so many different custom makers all over the world as part of these groups on social media. So I'm going to bring you the first of four customs that I'm going to show you on this episode. And this first one is one of the members of the Hart Foundation. Here we go. All right. Made by Richard Turner. Big shout out to Richard Turner there. Jim the Anvil Neidhart. One of the members of the original Hart Foundation, of course. The Anvil. The one thing I would say I don't like about this particular figure is the pink beard. I think that's a bit over the top. But definitely think the Anvil is a cool addition. And he, of course, the likeness is pretty good there as well. This is the custom version of the Anvil. All pink outfit with the Anvil, the black Anvil in the front. Very cool figure indeed. Richard Turner making a lot of good ones there, as is another custom maker that I be in touch with that makes them, who I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. But good stuff there. Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Good stuff. The next set of customs this time I'm going to talk about is the Fabulous Rougeau Brothers. Of course, the Canadians, the French Canadians from Montreal, Quebec, Canada, came into the WWF in around 86. Had a great run in the WWF until 1990. Jacques Rougeau and Raymond Rougeau, the Rougeau brothers. And of course, they made a good name for themselves. Not won any titles, but they definitely were in contention. Great storylines with the British Bulldogs. Also, storylines with the likes of the Bushwhackers and the Hart Foundation, among others. A very good addition to the roster for a long time. Of course, Jacques went on to become the Mountie and went on to become one of the Quebecers, and then had a great career beating Hulk Hogan off screen, of course, in one of their house shows for WCW. He beat Hulk Hogan. And Jacques Rougeau and Raymond Rougeau, the Fabulous Rougeau brothers there. Another great addition made by Matthew Durrell. Big shout out to Matthew Durrell. He makes a lot of great Hasbro customs. And these ones are no exception. The Fabulous Rougeau Brothers, the latest in my look at some great customs from the Hasbro Customs universe. Okay, so the final of the customs that I'm going to talk about today on this episode of Keoster's Wrestlefest Wrestling Prime Times. This one is Haku, King Haku. This outfit, of course, is the King's Crown on the front. But great addition as well, made by Matthew Durrell as well. Haku, of course, King Haku came to prominence in WWF back in the late 80s. I was, of course, first known as King Tonga as part of the Islanders, and then went on to become King Haku, and Haku teaming up with Andre the Giant in the Colossal Connection, of course. And he, of course, went to WWF till around 92, and then he went to WCW as Meng, and had a great career there, as well as part of the Dungeon of Doom and the Faces of Fear, teaming up with the Barbarian, and as who was, of course, his partner in the Heenan family for a while in the WWF. But Haku, great figure, has to be probably one of the best of the customs that I've had so far. And Matthew Durrell, the maker, great stuff indeed. There you go, that's the final off the look at the Hasbro customs today on this episode of Keoster's Wrestlefest for YouTube and CKTV. Thank you, guys. Okay, guys, you did see there the classic Hasbros and classic customs there as part of the collection. Next section of the show now, we're going to look at some classic wrestling VHSs as part of Wrestlefest tonight. And in this episode, we're going to look at two classic SummerSlams. And this year will be, of course, SummerSlam 21. It's not something I'll be watching, but as I'm not really a modern wrestling watcher these days. But the old school had a lot of big, big events at SummerSlam time of the year. And the first one we're going to look at, it's actually 2 years running we're going to look at. We're going to look at the 1989 SummerSlam, and then we're going to look at SummerSlam 90. 89 was Feel the Heat. 1990 was The Heat Returns. So 88 was the first ever SummerSlam, but we're going to look at these two because these two are two of the ones that I watched first. So I'm going to switch over here now and have a look at these. Okay, so SummerSlam 1989, Feel the Heat. Of course, it was main evented by Hulk Hogan and Brutus the Barber Beefcake, teaming up against the Macho Man Randy Savage and Zeus, the Human Wrecking Machine, who was, of course, in the movie with Hulk Hogan, No Holds Barred. And this was like a follow-on from the movie. The movie was just made around just before this in 1989. And big deal at the time. Great stuff. Great video. This is a video, actually. I didn't actually see SummerSlam 89 until about 8 years later, around 98, 99, I discovered it and thought it was brilliant. You know, I did watch a lot of the old pay-per-views from about 1990 onwards, but SummerSlam 89 wasn't one that I really got into until later. So, this is a great event. Tony Schiavone on his podcast does a great running commentary on it, along with Conrad Thompson, of course, if you ever check that podcast out, it's really cool. But here's this is the card for SummerSlam 89. You've got some great matches there. The Fabulous Rougeau brothers against the Rockers and Tito Santana. The Rougeaus teaming up with Rick Martel. Of course, you've got Greg Valentine, Hercules, Red Rooster versus Mr. Perfect. The Brainbusters against the Hart Foundation. You've got the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase versus Superfly Jimmy Snuka. Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream versus the Honky Tonk Man. And of course, you've got Andre the Giant and the Twin Towers teaming against Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Demolition. You've got the Warrior versus Rick Rude. And you've got that big main event, as we talked about already. Great, great event. I would definitely rank it up there with the best of the SummerSlams. That's why I've singled it out to look at it tonight, along with the other one. So, definitely good stuff there. One of my favourites in the old school wrestling collection. Okay, so the next one we're going to look at on this episode of Keoster's Wrestlefest Wrestling Prime Times. Another SummerSlam here, and this is SummerSlam 90, The Heat Returns. And it was, of course, the Warrior versus Rick Rude in a steel cage for the world title, and then you had Hulk Hogan versus the Earthquake in a match as well, rivalry match, big grudge match. And of course, that was the double main event. Of course, also on the card for SummerSlam 90, you had matches such as the Rockers against Power and Glory, you had the Warlord versus Tito Santana, you had Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Nikolai Volkov versus the Orient Express. You also had, of course, the Macho King Randy Savage versus Dusty Rhodes and American Dream. You also had the likes of Jake the Snake versus Bad News Brown. You had some great matches, including Kerry Von Erich, the Texas Tornado, versus Mr. Perfect for the Intercontinental title. Great event. One of the first ones, actually, that I got in my collection back in the day. I got, I think it was the third wrestling video I got back in the day from the shop. And it was a great one indeed. And definitely one of the top SummerSlams, in my opinion. Definitely a top five as far as best of the 33, 34 SummerSlams that there has been. I'd say this one's up there in the top five for sure. Alright, that's the last of the VHS videos we're going to look at on this episode of Keoster's Wrestlefest. Okay, so the next part of the show, I'm going to have a look at some music videos featuring the world of wrestling. So the first music video we're going to look at here now is one from Coco Beware. It was part of the Wrestling Album 2 from back in the late 80s. And it was, of course, featuring Coco Beware. The video itself features lots of big names, but this one is called Pile Driver. And it did feature on a Saturday night's main event back in the day. Here it is. Okay, so we go from that very cool song, Pile Driver, to a tune that was sang by the Hot Rod, Rowdy Roddy Piper, around 1993-94. And he brought it out, of course, as a kind of a tongue-in-cheek look at his rivalry with Hogan over the years. And it was a great music video, great song, actually. It surprised me how good the song was. This is called I'm Your Man, and this is by Rowdy Roddy Piper.
I've been watching you all night, 'cause everything about you, it's so right.
been looking for you all my life.
That wraps up another episode of Keoster's Wrestlefest Wrestling Prime Times here on CKTV and YouTube. I hope you enjoyed the show. Lots of great memories and great segments from the history of pro wrestling. Lots of great videos and trailers of some of the great music videos involving wrestlers, and of course some of the great movies, the trailers for the movies, and of course you've seen some great Hasbros and customs during that episode. I'll be back whenever I feel like it, to do another episode of YouTube CKTV Keoster's Wrestlefest. Bye for now, everyone. Bye for now, everyone. Have a superplex day and a turnbuckle tomorrow. Take it easy.